this point, we have introduced the vital signs of the economy. You should have a good grasp of GDP, unemployment, and inflation. They will be the barometers in which we gauge how healthy the economy is. In the next section of the course, we'll introduce some economic models that will help us identify how people behave and the economic outcomes as the economy changes. The first model that we will introduce is called the competitive markets model, also often referred to as supply and demand model. In macroeconomics, we will do a quick summary of it and then apply it to a specific context. If you take my microeconomics course, I go in more depth with supply and demand. Over the next couple of videos, we'll introduce competitive market system and then introduce the loanable funds market. The loanable funds market will explain savings and borrowing behavior and how that impacts interest rates in the economy. When we discuss economic models, it is important for us to introduce the assumptions that we are relying on. Every model has basic assumptions that must exist, and our predictive outcomes will be sensitive to whether those assumptions hold or not. It is also important to note that economic models are abstract. They are not complete representations of reality. Adding too much detail can at times reduce the usefulness of the model. This is actually a good example of what I mean. Let's assume I draw this on your assignment. What is it? What point does it get across? I think most would call this a happy face or a smiley face, and it represents happiness. In the case that you find this on your assignment, it would communicate to you that your professor is pleased with your work. However, this is literally just two dots and a curve. There's nothing about this that indicates that it is a face. It is an abstract representation of reality. It is a model. If we attempt to make it more realistic, it might actually lose its meaning. For instance, to make this more realistic, we might want to add a little bit more detail in the eyes. We also need a nose. We need eyelashes, eyebrows, ears, hair. Don't forget my beard. This has more detail, but does it still hold the same meaning? It probably does not. If a professor drew this on your assignment, I'm sure you won't have the same reaction as you did to the happy face. You will notice the same thing with our economic models. They might be abstract at times, but they will help us explain something very well. However, the lack of detail or strong assumptions might make the model less useful in different contexts. Economists spend a lot of our time trying to identify which models to use in different situations. There are two main types of models to explain markets. We have competitive market models and imperfect competition models. Our focus in this series of videos will be on competitive markets. What do we mean by competitive markets? Competitive markets are markets where products being sold are homogeneous, meaning that they are identical or very similar across all vendors. A competitive market also has many buyers and many sellers. This means that no one buyer or seller has an influence on price or impacts the overall market. Competitive markets are also markets where entry and exit by firms is relatively easy. Also, information is assumed to be information about quality is assumed to be readily available, and information about pricing as well. These are the basic assumptions of the model. Relaxing these assumptions requires us to change the model. We would have to look at imperfect competition models. Let us dig a little deeper into our competitive market. Let us assume a hypothetical market. Pick a market that fits the characteristics outlined above. A competitive market has buyers and sellers, and we will refer to them as demanders and suppliers, or demand and supply. Demanders' willingness to buy will be influenced and can be changed based on their income, prices of related goods, their taste and preferences, the number of other buyers in the market, the expectation of future prices, meaning that if they expect prices to increase or decrease in the future, and then also on taxes and subsidies on that good. Suppliers, on the other hand, are influenced by the cost of their input and technology and production process. They are also influenced by the number of other sellers in the market. Price expectation of future prices is also a determinant, and then taxes and subsidies. Competitive markets try to balance demand and supply. The changing environment can be balanced through prices specifically. If there are shortages in the market, prices will increase to reflect that scarcity. If there is a surplus, prices will fall. There are often many factors changing all at once, and we want to be able to identify the changes that are happening. In the case of demand, changes in buyer behavior we will summarize in two main ways. The first is through the law of demand, and that tells us that as prices fall, people increase the amount they want to consume. This inverse relationship holds for most products in the competitive market. The other reason buyers change their behavior might be due to the demand determinants that we previously mentioned. In economics, when we want to indicate that people are changing their behavior due to changes in prices, we refer to that as a change in quantity demanded. On the other hand, if buyers' behavior change is due to something other than price, we refer to that as a change in demand. This is a subtle difference in language, but it is an important one in economics and has implications. We will look at graphical examples because these changes might sound similar, but they look very different. This also holds on the supply side. The law of supply states that as price increases, firms will respond by increasing the quantity that they are willing to supply. If the change is due to a change that is not a change in price, then we refer to that as a change in behavior or a change in supply. Let us look at a graphical example. We'll use graphs to simplify our analysis. The main framework and convention in economics is to plot price on the y-axis and the quantity on the x-axis. The law of demand tells us that there is an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded, so demand will have a negative slope. At point A, the price is $15 and the quantity demanded is 3. As price increases to $20, we move to point B where quantity demanded falls to 2. Recognize that the change in behavior is due to changes in prices, so this is a change in quantity demanded. Similarly, the law of supply states that there is a positive relationship between price and quantity supplied. At point A, the price is $15 and the quantity supplied is 2. As prices increase to 20, firms increase the quantity supplied to 5 units. Changes due to changes in price will lead to a move along the supply or demand curve. If changes in the market are actually due to changes in determinants of demand, then we will observe a shift in the entire demand curve. An increase in demand is represented with a shift to the right. A good example of this is in the markets for normal goods. When income increases, demand at every price level increases. A decrease in demand will lead to a shift of the demand curve to the left. Changes in the determinants of supply can be represented the same way. Favorable market conditions that increase the firm's ability or willingness to produce will cause a shift to the of the supply curve to the right. Unfavorable market conditions reduce the supply curve or shift it to the left. An important aspect of competitive markets is the equilibrium. The equilibrium is the price in which markets clear, or in other words, where supply equals demand. Changes in the economy are continuously acting on this market, and therefore prices will change to clear the market. If price is not at equilibrium, it will adjust to find the correct level. If price is too high, the market will have excess supply and prices will fall. if price is for some reason too low, there will be a shortage in the market and prices will adjust upwards. If demand increases, then old prices would be too low and prices of the product will eventually increase. If demand falls, then old prices are now too high and the market price will begin to fall to reflect the market change. If there's a change on the supply side of the market that allows firms to produce more, then supply increases and prices will adjust downward. If supply decreases, then the market prices will adjust upward. The competitive market model is a useful model. I do have to be clear that there are more models that reflect different aspects of economic activity. We will rely on the competitive model to introduce other models. We will also use the competitive market model to help explain how savers and borrowers behave. It will allow us to understand the market for loans, what we will call the loanable funds model. In this video, we introduced the idea of economic models. We introduced the competitive market model. We spent time learning about buyers and the difference between demand and quantity demanded. We also learned about supply and quantity supplied. We use graphical representation to show the difference between a movement along a curve and a shift of a curve. We also define market equilibrium and discussed how markets adjust when conditions change. Whether it is supply or demand that is changing, we know how to apply it now. Make sure to practice the problems, and I'll see you next class.